In light of conflicting claims and opinions in the media about whether airborne transmission of Ebola virus is possible, I decided to pay a visit to the library to review the medical literature myself. What I found is that the answer we get seems to depend on the mode of aerosol delivery investigated. Those modes being either mechanical aerosol produced by a machine in the laboratory, or natural aerosol produced by expiration in the open air. And in every study where lab animals were hooked up to a machine that produces a fine aerosol mist contaminated with Ebola, the virus was successfully transmitted to the animals. That is airborne transmission, demonstrated repeatedly, and the sizes of the carrier droplets are the same size as moisture droplets we exhale. In fact, aerosol transmission proves so effective, three of these studies were Ebola vaccine studies that happened to use aerosolized Ebola as the exposure method. So it is an accepted fact in science that under controlled laboratory conditions, airborne transmission of Ebola reliably occurs. However, putting this into perspective, two scientists from the Center for Disease Control stated in a 1999 review, quote, "The data on formal aerosol experiments leave no doubt that Ebola and Marburg viruses are stable and infectious in small particle aerosols. However, this is far from saying that Ebola viruses are transmitted in the clinical setting by small particle aerosols generated from patients." End of quote. Fortunately, there does appear to be a difference between mechanical and natural aerosol transmission. In 2012, a study reported open-air transmission of Ebola from pigs to monkeys. All the monkeys exposed only to the same air as Ebola-infected pigs became infected and died. However, the authors note that pigs exhale larger moisture droplets than other species. Additionally, I found research showing that Ebola targets the lungs of pigs far more so than other species, leading researchers to conclude that pigs may be capable of shedding relatively high viral loads into the environment. So these factors, unique among pigs, may be why airborne transmission did not occur between infected and non-infected monkeys in the same setting where pig-to-monkey airborne transfer occurred. Furthermore, in a study published this year, researchers also reported the failure of natural aerosol transmission between monkeys housed in separate cages in the same room. Their cage setup is shown here. However, in 1995, scientists reported the unintended transmission of Ebola to two control monkeys that were separated from infected monkeys. The scientists attributed this anomaly to airborne transmission. So while it seems that pig-to-monkey aerosol transmission occurs readily, monkey-to-monkey transmission seems to be rare, if it occurs at all. So the research in this area is mixed. Finally, we consider epidemiological research on human transmission during Ebola outbreaks. In these studies, researchers deduced probable cause of transmission from retrospective interviews of survivors, friends, or family members. Of all 9 epidemiological studies I found, only 2 present clues of possible airborne transmission. In the other 7 studies, all cases examined could be explained by direct contact. In the first of the 2 exceptions, 5 out of 44 cases could not be explained by physical contact, so the researchers argued for the likelihood of airborne transmission in those 5 cases. The second study merely states that 2 out of 122 cases were not linked to recognized chains of transmission. The authors elaborate no further, But that seems to imply, as with the five previous cases, that physical contact was not an explanation for those two cases. Of course, the likelihood of error here is high. It might be that all seven unexplained cases were not caused by airborne transmission. Conversely, it could be that some cases attributed to physical contact were actually due to airborne transmission. We have to keep in mind that these retrospective epidemiological studies are founded on the fallible memories of survivors, friends, or family members. That said, there are many reasons to believe, based on internal consistencies, that these studies are at least mostly accurate. So there's every reason to believe that natural airborne transmission of Ebola among humans has been extremely rare, if it has ever occurred. Yet based on the laboratory data, we know that airborne transmission is theoretically possible. So the prudent position would seem to be that we cannot and should not rule out the possibility of airborne transmission. And that precautionary stance has been expressed by scientists over the decades, since Ebola was discovered in 1976.